Please give a warm Pacific Northwest welcome for Dr. Lawrence Yoon.
Thank you, Georgie.
Thank you very much. Glad to have you.
Very glad to be here. The Pacific Northwest, because in fact, the whole West Coast region right now, I would say the housing market is heating up perhaps a little too fast. You are seeing more business activity. Perhaps there is some question about, with the prices rising so much and multiple bidding occurring so commonly, that are we reintroducing the bubble experience of what we encountered 10 years ago? And subsequently, should we anticipate some harsh crash landing, or is it different this time around? Well, first, we had a report come out yesterday, which was about the realtor member profile. Who are our realtor members? In the introduction, it mentioned 1 million members across the country. It is now 1.1 million members. So people are seeing a possible business opportunity they're entering. We, meaning the NAR, local association, have no control over how many people come in. If they want to come in, this is free enterprise. They come in, they exit if things do not turn out. So we have no control over this. I would say with more people coming in, it probably means that we have to focus more on professionalism, because sometimes some of the new people who are come in, they may not fully understand all the intricacy of the businesses. And real estate is a very unique business in a sense that it requires two people cooperation to get the closing done. It's not one person, it's two realtors representing buyer and seller to get the closing done. But in order to get the closing done, sometimes one of the realtors may be doing 80% of the work. So it depends, so that we have to be concerned about some of the professionalism aspect of our industry with more people coming in. Now, having said that, I will say that also that typical realtor member income in our latest information was about $45,000, roughly speaking. But that's a highly misleading number, because this is a entrepreneurial business. About 20-25% of our membership, 20 or 25% of you, get six-figure gross commission income. 30% of you get less than $20,000 in gross commission income. So the average point is about $45,000, but it's a huge wide variance, which means that some of you succeed well, others are more challenged. Why one succeed over others? I guess it's partly related to business experience, assuring that your clients are fully satisfied with your service, because most of the realtor businesses still comes through their referrals, their recommendation from friends and family members. Now, another interesting statistics that came out is that there is a greater use of technology among realtor members. They have to be. Your clients are using technology, therefore you have to be even edgier, even a little ahead of your clients, at least related to real estate transaction in technology. The last time I purchased a home, I remember my hand being very tired. It was due to sign this, sign that. Before you know it, you're just signing forever. Maybe with DocuSign, that will minimize some of the amount we have to sign, transfer of documents back and forth. Another interesting statistics from yesterday's member profile information is that average age of a realtor is 56, I believe, maybe 55, 56. Which is implying that maybe the clients want the experienced realtor. Or it could be that there's an opportunity for some of the younger people to come into the business, because maybe the millennials, as they are thinking about their first time home, that they want to be more affiliated, or they feel closer affinity to people of similar age. So if you are a broker, maybe you should put a more concerted effort in trying to recruit younger members. We have seen the first-time buyer percentage drop to 25-year low levels. But I anticipate that it will be slowly picking up because the economy has been consistently picking up in recent times. So given that condition, is that the buyers are looking for experienced realtor, or are the buyers looking for people of similar age group? But currently, the median age is 56 years old. Now to the technology. We should be grateful for all the technology that is occurring in the country. You know, the use of iPhones, and I think there is an interesting article in the latest weekly magazine called The Economist. I'm being The Economist, I look at the magazine, and it's a topic about gender inequality or gender fairness, and it's not what you think. It's more about males who graduate from college in the past could expect a decent income working at a factory. But because of the technological revolution, those jobs are disappearing. We have robots producing. So what happens to many of the, say, people who just graduate from college? They have no desire to get further education, but they want to work in a factory, but those factory jobs are no longer available. So what happens? So it's interesting how the technology is changing some of the gender power relationship. People who are getting college degree, graduate education, they're doing all fine, much better. I mean, people are working at Apple, Google, you know, they're doing all fine, as you can imagine. But what happens to the factory workers as we have more robots and more technology innovation part? The age 56 of typical realtors, that's also a very interesting comparison. Go back to the year 1900, before all of us were born. What was the life expectancy in the United States, one of the most developed countries in the world? The life expectancy back then was, I think, like a 45, 46. But today, life expectancy is, as you know, much larger than that, so we should be grateful for medical technology innovation. One other statistics that you may be unaware of because of the better in technology, and again, technology has a really liberated woman because you know you don't have to spend many hours doing the laundry and other part. But before 1900, I mean, people just take it for granted that somehow women always live a longer life than men. But before 1900, the life expectancy of men actually was higher than the life expectancy of women, because every childbirth was potential death sentence before the that period. So if you look at that, so you know, technology is all good. I'm glad to see in our member profile that realtors are getting more involved, and certainly there's a lot of competition between Realtor.com, Zillow, and other, you know, the MLSs in trying to bring the most user-friendly technology. I think it's still a shakeout period, meaning that it's a heavy competition, and let's see how what happens over time. But I'm glad that many of you are getting involved in the technology. I'm here to give you outlook on the broad economy as well as the housing market, what you can anticipate going forward. And I would say that broadly speaking, in terms of the business opportunity, it should be an improving environment. As I mentioned, some of you do very well, six-figure incomes, others are challenged. I don't know how you know that will change over time. I think that will probably continue, but hopefully some of this information that you can utilize in your business. I don't really see this time as being a bubble. I am more concerned about the price increases in a sense that it could choke off some of the first-time buyers. First-time buyers, now they're getting a little better jobs than before. They're trying to save up for down payment, but as they are saving money, if they see home values rising 9%, 10%, 11%, they look at the bank account and say, am I making any progress towards down payment? So, you know, those are very demoralizing, frustrating situation. We need to tame the home price growth. It's not a bubble. I don't think there will be any price crash for people who recently purchased. Or if you're homeowners, am I concerned? I would say no, that's not the concern. But we just want to assure that price increases are much more moderate pace so that we can have more Americans, more younger generation, able to participate in this housing market recovery. So I am scheduled to speak two times right now, and then once again a little later after the break, two times. So the way I'm going to break it out is I will discuss the economic picture in the first half and then go into the real estate in the second half. Economy determines everything. Economy is about jobs, income, inflation, interest rates, how that will be. So some of this information, in your day-to-day conversation with your clients, maybe it gives the image that you are really on top of what's happening in the economy. Because one of the things about the clients is, when they purchase a home, they want to trust you. Can I trust you to get that, get the job done? And more knowledge certainly enhances that trust. So how is the economy? Very, very simple question. And the economy has been like this. So let me actually put my finger here. So this is the Great Recession, where we had a huge, massive job losses during the financial market crisis. Subprime mortgages exploding. Lehman Brothers, one major Wall Street company, going bankrupt. That was the time when government brought a stimulus program of money, a large amount of money. Many Americans were frustrated. Why is the money going to the banking system? But this was the Great Recession, second worst economic times in America. The worst economic time was the 1930s during the Great Depression period. So this was the second worst. And then you see some economic growth. So this is GDP is a measurement of total production in America. But every once in a while, you see a little red. In fact, I would say that this time last year, one could actually use a teenage adjective term for the economy. That is to say, economy was awesome. And this is the middle of last year, this two-bar chart, because it was growing at essentially 5%. If the GDP grows at 5%, those are awesome figures. So it was growing at awesome. The problem is, it's not awesome consistently. It fizzled out in the fourth quarter, and the first quarter of this year is actually negative. There's reason why it's negative this first quarter. It's a one-time factor. Second half of this year, it'll be positive. But on the GDP, it's been inconsistent in terms of recovery. This is a long historical GDP chart. So I think with little formatting, things did not come out well. But this is 1950, from 1950 all the way to 2014, so on an annual basis, not on a quarterly basis. And this red line should be more closer to 3%. So, but anyway, one can see that in the past, economy is never, very robust. There's a little choppiness, but generally speaking, it was much higher level of activity here than in more recent years. And in fact, if you listen to some of the presidential candidates now, if you listen to carefully, they will reference GDP. I think on the Republican side, there are probably 19 people running. On Democrat side, I think there's one, clear leader, unless, something happens. But one of the things that you will hear from the presidential candidate is that we have to get the GDP up to 4%. We have to get GDP up to 5%, and it will solve many of the problems. And I will say, if that can be done, it will solve many of the problems. But the question is, how do we get there, 4 or 5% GDP, because we have been under 3% for 10 straight years. Why is 3%? Well, 3% is historical average. U.S. has always grown at 3%. During the President Eisenhower term, President Truman term, it was much above 3% consistently. And that was the time also a very simple question to Americans. Will your children be better off in the future? And Americans say, yeah, of course. There's no doubt about it. My children will be absolutely better than because the economy was rolling along. You ask the same question today, and I believe the survey result from Gallup poll or Pew Research would say something about half of Americans believe their children will be better off than how they have experienced financially. Other half saying, no, my children will be worse off than how I have experienced financially. And one of the reason why they are indicating as such is because economy has been sluggish. It's been a sluggish growth compared to what had happened in the past. The same question today in China, you ask that in China, Chinese will say, definitively, my children will be better than how I have lived, because their GDP is rolling along at about 7%. And they are not happy with 7% GDP, because they are used to 10% GDP. So this is what we are in terms of how the economy has been doing. Now, let me put the chart slightly differently. So this is not in terms of percentage growth, but actual total output of everyone combined in America. So you produce something this year, your relatives produce, you know, other fellow Americans produce things. Everything we produce in America, dollar volume, how much are we doing economic activity? So overall, it grows. And then we hit a recession, Great Recession, so it went down. And after the Great Recession, it's been recovering, but the recovery growth has been about 2.2% annual average, not the 3%. Historically in America, when there is a recession, it tends to bounce back. It tends to grow 4 or 5% just so that we get that 3% average quickly. But this time, we're not getting that 3% average. We are slugging along at 2%. So I put the hypothetical line of 3%. What would have happened if we had grown at 3%? And you see the gap between what we are experiencing versus what we could have done. And the gap is about $1.7 trillion. I have a smart aleck son, a teenage boy, high school, sophomore. He thinks he knows everything. So I ask him a simple question. I don't call him a smart aleck at home. I call him something else. So how many zeros in $1 trillion? So like a typical kid, he gets out an iPhone and tried to Google it. No. How many zeros in $1 trillion? And he doesn't know. And he doesn't need to know. It's huge. It's large. So put our numbers around it. I put a per person basis, and it is about $5,000 per person in America. That's the gap. What that means is that if the economy had grown at 3% rather than 2% cumulatively over this almost a decade period, you would have additional $5,000 in your pocket. But you are missing that. Not only you, but your brother would have additional $5,000 in your pocket. This is per person in America, all across. So on average, Americans are missing about $5,000. This is the consequence of having slow economic growth. Many of the presidential candidates will say, if you elect me, I'm going to get the GDP up to 4% or 5%. Now, they can all say that. How it gets accomplished, you know, is a different thing. But we see the real consequence of why what happens if we have a sluggish economic expansion. Now, some people, some economists actually would say that, hey, 2% growth, we should be happy about that. Why? Look at Japan, they're growing at zero. I mean, China is growing, but not Japan. Japan is growing at zero. Look at Europe, broadly speaking. Europe as a whole is growing at zero. We are growing at 2%. We should be celebrating at 2%. So maybe something has changed globally, so maybe we should be happy with 2%. Or we should say, no, this is not America. America always, on average, grows at 3%. And to maintain that economic supremacy, that economic lead, we need to assure that we go back to the, at least the historical average conditions. But because the economy, 2% is still positive, it's not negative, it's positive. Growing at 2% means that overall we are creating jobs. So we lost 8 million jobs, but now we have created 12 million jobs in the country as a whole. And there looks like more jobs will be created. And by the way, generally speaking, Oregon and Washington, and I would include Idaho, as whatever nation does, Oregon, Washington, and Idaho will do a little better than the nation. That's the long-term historical trend. So if the U.S. is growing at 2%, Oregon, Washington, Idaho may be growing at 3%. So it's always tends to be a little better than the rest. California bounces around. Sometimes they do well, sometimes they don't, but it bounces around. But the Pacific Northwest generally outpaces the nation. So we are seeing job creation. And also, this is an indication that more job creation is surely will happen later in the year. Why? This is the number of people who are filing for unemployment insurance for the first time. So you are working for a company, you get laid off, you file for this, but it's essentially saying the companies are no longer laying off people. So therefore, the more job creation is nearly assured. Unemployment rate also is now falling, and some of you have taken an Econ 101 course, and there are many things there, and many of the things you may have forgotten. You know, when I take a topic that is not in my subject area, I quickly forget many things. But one of the things that may stick around is that in a free market country where companies have right to hire people and also right to fire people, there will always be unemployment rate. So what would be a good, honest unemployment rate? And it's about 5%, 5.5%. That's what the textbook would say. Today, we have unemployment rate at 5.5%. So in essence, we're saying maybe this is right conditions, 5.5% unemployment rate with the job creation. But you probably hear from many radio talk show hosts, TV programs, and other blog economic articles to say, look, unemployment rate is flawed. It doesn't include that. There are too many people not even in looking for jobs out of the labor force. So let's do something opposite. Instead of trying to measure how many people are unemployed, let's measure how many people are employed, how many people have jobs. So employment rate. Employment rate before the recession, sorry again, this is not coming out right in this projection, somehow the formatting got a change, but this is year 2000. So before the recession, about 63-64% of Americans had jobs. It's not 100% because people who are retired, they are saying, I did my time, now I'm going to enjoy the fruits of all my labor that I have done in the past. Some of the housewives with many young children for a few years, maybe they don't want to work, they want to stay at home to look after the family. So it's not 100%, but it was about 63, 64, 65%. Then we hit a recession. Far fewer people with jobs. We have created 12 million jobs, yet the employment rate is barely picking up. Because every year, we have fresh set of college graduates looking for jobs. So in a sense, we are creating this 12 million jobs over this multiple years, but we are just treading waters. Now for real estate, you still say thank you, thank you, thank you, because more jobs, 12 million jobs, means that additional people who are in a position or better position to become homeowners. But from the economy as a whole, we are just treading waters in terms of the employment rate because we are creating jobs, but not enough to really boost the employment rate upwards. And also in terms of jobs, we have larger percentage than normal of part-time employment now than before. Now, why is this the case? Now, some people say Affordable Care Act is part of the reason for small businesses, because if you click at a certain level, then you know you will have additional financial burden involved. But we have a little higher than normal percentage of part-time employment. So we do have 12 million jobs. Most of that 12 million jobs are full-time, but nonetheless, we are getting more higher percentage of part-time employment now than before. We are creating jobs, but the wages are not growing. Wages are barely budging. It's rising at 2%. So jobs are good, but the wages are not rising. Now, one thing that is discouraging at the moment is slow productivity growth. Simple definition, productivity. You work 40 hours a week. How much are you producing in terms of, say, people working in the factory, or how much are you producing? With better technology, we should be producing a little more each year with the same number of hours that we put in, because technology has made it possible to produce a little more. And historically, one can see that productivity growth is this, but one sees that in recent years, productivity growth has been very, very sluggish. And that is why the companies are reluctant to give higher wages, because workers are not being productive as before. And hence, this may, even though we're creating jobs, unemployment insurance filing is coming down, but some of the hiring decision may be less aggressive going forward unless productivity really begins to rise. Let's look at individual states. Not all states are equal. 49 out of the 50 states are creating jobs. You know, you may say it's still a sluggish creation of jobs, but they are creating jobs. Only one state, West Virginia, is negative, but even the slow creating states, they are still creating jobs. But let's look at the top gainers in the past 12 months. Utah is the clear lead. By the way, the governor of Utah is a former realtor. He participated in all the realtor committees, like at the national level, you know, various governance committee, like what do we do about Fannie and Freddie, or what do we do about mortgage interest deduction? So he was participating in that, and one thing led to another. He's the governor, and Utah is doing well. Florida is second. Oregon, Washington, California, Pacific Ocean states are right there, and then you see some. Idaho, Nevada, and then generally the second tier are generally the southern states, Georgia, Tennessee, South Carolina, North Carolina. North Dakota used to be number one for many years. Now they are no longer number one and they're likely to slide down. Texas used to be number two, but they don't even appear here. So what has happened to North Dakota and Texas? Oil prices. Oil prices have gone down. They were dependent on oil production, so they will continue to slide down on this scale. Now, falling oil prices is bad news for North Dakota and Texas, but it's a great news for state that does not produce oil, because you are consumers of oil, which means that on average, I did some calculation, on average, a typical family will save about $2,000 a year in gasoline usage this year versus last year from the low oil prices. So that's extra $2,000 you have to get spent on. So let's look at the Portland area. So the trend is, this is the internet stock bubble crash, then job creation, then the financial market crash, then now you are recovering. And the recovery path is hard to compare with the national, but just trust me, it's a little stronger compared to the national percentage growth. And furthermore, looks like you are almost reaching 1,125,000 jobs in the greater Portland metro area. 15 years ago, it was about 950,000. So let me do a quick math, it looks like about 150,000 additional jobs in the local region. 150,000 jobs additionally in the local region. That's like three stadiums full of people. If one stadium holds 50,000 people, that's three stadiums full of people, which means that you will feel this effect when you go home. Traffic is getting worse each single day. So that's the bad news, but the good news is that traffic is worse for the good reason, which is that jobs are being created. Many people are moving here. In fact, if one looks at the data a little micro level, the people who are moving here are people from California. And California, you welcome them because they sell their expensive homes in California. They come to Portland and say, wow, this is affordable, no big deal. Put additional $10,000 to the bid or whatever it is. So Californians are easily willing to do their multiple bidding because they are selling their very expensive home from California. You just wish that they had left their personality back there with them. But the movement is that, you know, California really bring that big cash when they come, especially relatively speaking, the prices are very affordable. Typical home value in San Francisco, San Jose is now reaching $1 million. And these are not large homes. Typical home price in the local region is about $280,000 or is now beginning to approach $300,000. So one can see that comparison. And by the way, your home prices is above the national average. You know, it's above the national average, but by California standards, it's very, very affordable. Let's look at consumer spending, oil prices. So oil prices are beneficial for the state of Oregon and many states across America that does not produce oil because you are the consumers of oil. And look at this trend. It went up, it crashed, then it started to go back up again. And then it crashed again. Now the question is it going to go back up once more? So this $2,000 bonus that you have in terms of not spending at the gas station, can you expect this going into next year? And I would say probably yes. Oil prices will not rise again. It will stay at about what it is now. I mean, it will move around, everything move around, but it will not go back up to $100 per barrel. because something has fundamentally changed. And what has fundamentally changed is the supply and demand related to oil in America. We have essentially doubled the production of oil in America. We used to produce 5 million barrels of oil per day. Now we are producing closer to 10. North Dakota, principally. North Dakota just drill and drill and drill. And they're still producing even at low oil prices. Why are they still producing at low oil prices? Because once you drill it, just get it out. It doesn't matter what the price is, because if you don't get it out, you lose money. You lose greater money. So all this additional capacity has led to the doubling of the production in the U.S. At the same time, we are consuming less oil than before. We used to consume over 20 million barrels. Now we are consuming 19 million barrels because of green energy. Car fuel efficiency, the mileage that you are getting on your car is much longer now than before. So we are using less energy than before. All this green technology, more consciousness of green energy. So that has led to it. But note that we are still importing oil from abroad because we are using more than what we produce. So we used to import 2/3 of our oil. Now we are importing only half of our oil. Some people will make claim that America should be energy self-sufficient, independent. Well, those are great goals, but I think in trying to accomplish that, it will be very, very difficult given the realities of the numbers. But you know, at least the trend is, you know, we produce more, we consume less, we will certainly be less dependent on oil overseas. So this is the reason why I don't see oil prices going back up to $100 per barrel, or consequently, you know, $4 or $4.50 per gallon at the gas station. There's another geopolitical element to it. Every country is producing at the maximum. Russia is at the maximum. America is at their maximum capacity. Venezuela at the maximum capacity. Only country that is not at the maximum capacity is Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the only country that can dial, produce a little more, produce a little less, because you know they are sitting on the sea of oil, and they have that little luxury of moving the dial back and forth. And at the moment, Saudi Arabia incentive is to produce a little more to keep the prices down. Why would the Saudis interested in keeping the price down? They don't like Iran. They consider that Iran as their regional threat, and Iran. Economy is dependent upon oil. If oil price is low, it could cause major disruption, possibly major social unrest in Iran. So, and Saudis know that Iran is trying to become very aggressive in the region, and one of the ways to tame Iran is to get the oil prices down. So I think the Saudi have that political incentive to keep the oil prices down by producing a little more than normal. So aside from the U.S. fundamental change, I think that some of the geopolitical situation will keep the oil prices low. If you're a commercial producer, this is great news. One of the big operating costs of running commercial building is energy costs. So low energy costs makes it more profitable in running the buildings. The other aspect of the consumers is the consumers are much better positioned now. Their home equity loan borrowing has really come down than before. I mean, they were borrowing money to buy SUVs, but now it's coming down. Their credit card balance is also coming down. So overall, consumers are more cautious about taking on additional loans. One chart that I have not shown here, and it's a little scary chart, is student debt load. I mean, that is exploding. It's rising very, very fast. So at least for subcategory of people, recent college graduates, they are carrying this large student debt loan, and that may delay some of the home ownership opportunities. One, it counts towards that debt-to-income ratio in filing for mortgages, so it's actual number of calculation that impacts. But the second is psychological. If you have large student debt, you know, $40,000, $60,000, somehow psychologically you say, I don't want to have another debt. I want to pay this off before taking another new debt. So psychologically, I think that may postpone some of the millennials from entering the market. But broadly speaking, you know, people are using less credit card, less using their housing as an ATM machine. Now, consumer spending is overall, I would say, respectable. This is the retail sales at the retail shops. So for commercial members, you can expect increased occupancy rate on some of the retail businesses. But the real big business opportunity is on e-commerce. So let me just go back. This is growing at about 6%, 5 or 6% retail shops. But e-commerce is growing at 15%, three times as fast as the physical retail shop, which means that employment is more active in warehousing compared to at the retail shops. So if you're a commercial broker, look for a building that is unattractive. People always look at retail shop as, you know, this looks nice, this looks nice. If you look at warehouses, it's behind that railroad track, you know, dark visible. But that's where the money is, because this is where the demand for, because, you know, people sell through Amazon, other online sales, they need those warehouse spaces quickly, and that's where the demand is occurring. Strong dollar impact is positive and negative. This is the dollar against all other currency globally, just measuring. So this is dollar strengthening, little weakening, and now strengthening again against other currencies. I think there are some Wall Street firms who said, bet against the dollar. Federal Reserve is printing way too much money. Anytime you print the money, it will damage the currency. So bet against the dollar. Well, dollar is strengthening. So people who made those bet that dollar will weaken from so much printing of the money are coming out in a wrong way because dollar has really strengthened. And the way to visualize this, this is something that I heard from one of the economists at some different conference, is that you look for the cleanest clothes in your dirty laundry basket. And every global economy, every country is in a this deep crisis, you know, huge budget deficit, they're printing money, everything. So of all this mess, which one looks the cleanest? And it's the U.S. U.S. Just looks the cleanest among all this problematic financial situation, and that's why the dollar is strengthening. So the dollar is strengthening has an impact import exports. On imports, America is now enticed to buy more foreign products. Foreign products will look cheaper, or you have more incentive to travel abroad. Dollar carries a stronger purchasing power. But the export will be more difficult. So Nike will have some trouble trying to sell more because the American produced product will be more expensive than before. So it will have some impact on the trade balance. But the benefit of the strong dollars is that it keeps the interest rate low. So things that is related to borrowing and purchasing, the interest rate remains low, which is the reason, one of the reasons why mortgage rates still remains at this unimaginable low rates because the dollar is strong. But there's one currency that is stalking the dollar, that is strengthening against the dollar over time, and that is the Chinese currency. And you know what happens regarding this, because if you look at what was the major currency 100 years ago, it was the British pound. One British pound can command 4 or 5 US dollars. That was the currency, global currency. British lost to the US, so one British pound no longer can command $4 or $5. One British pound gets a little over a dollar. So the British pound has lost that luster. But Chinese currency, $1 used to get 8.5. Now $1 gets about 6. And I think $1 may get, this one is not showing, but may get 5 within a few years. So Chinese currency is strengthening, and if people believe Chinese currency can be a global reserve currency, then it changes the whole political dynamics. And this is where I think the interest comes, just for disclosure, I'm not Chinese. I'm a Korean born, but came to America at a very young age. So, you know, I don't have any stake in China, but the thing on China, I think, for U.S. just broadly to step back and to think about is Chinese GDP is likely to surpass U.S. GDP. On a per-person basis, it is still not near U.S. So I think typical Chinese earns about $15,000 a year. So it's much below the America. But they have massive population. So a total is matching up with the U.S. The total matters because what is their financial capacity to spend on defense spending? for military. That now they're in a comparable position as the U.S. So the question becomes, in the future, will the Chinese be a good guy or a bad guy? Because right now they're fighting over those artificial islands in the Pacific Ocean, and it's a really dangerous game. Because, I mean, when I say artificial, it's just the ocean. They dump a lot of sand and make it into a little island, and they said, this is our island. And then, you know, Philippines and Vietnam, they're arguing over it. You know, so what are you arguing over such a artificial? Well, all the fishing rights and all the other thing that goes along with it. So, but as Chinese become more aggressive, and the Philippines or Vietnam begins to call America to say, help us out, and America try to help out or try to at least establish international status quo, and China do not like that, then what happens? You know, what, because now their military capacity could slowly creep up and steadily match the U.S., and the big question becomes, will China be a good guy or a bad guy in the future? Because their economy is strengthening, their currency is strengthening, so many, many things are, at least the financial-wise, is moving in the right direction in China, which is also the reason, going to my very earlier slide, if the U.S. GDP can grow at 4 or 5%, then we would put China at a more distant level than before. So monetary policy, so I think this is my final topic before the break. So what can you expect regarding interest rate policy? Strong dollar has partly helped in terms of why we have this low interest rate environment. But the other reason is just the Federal Reserve wanted to keep the interest rate low. This is their short-term Federal Reserve policy. And along with this, they've been printing a lot of money. And as a result, 10-year Treasury has fallen, mortgage rate has fallen to just unimaginable low rates. Many realtors who have been in the business for, you know, multiple years, when the mortgage rate hit 6%, you said, wow, this is amazing. Then it hit 5%, and you just cannot believe that it hit 5%. Then it hit 4%. But this low interest rate environment is coming to an end. Federal Reserve will be raising rates sometime this year, in my view. I think it's going to be October. And with that, it's a great signal to the bond market that the mortgage rate will be rising. But the mortgage rate will be rising in a manageable way. I don't think it will damage the housing market. But one thing that may hold back Federal Reserve policy is that we don't have any inflation at the moment. So inflation is essentially zero. Some of the prices are rising, but gasoline prices are low, so that compensates as to why we have zero inflation. So as a result, if you're a senior on a Social Security check, next year, cost of living adjustment on your Social Security check will probably be zero, because government will say there's no inflation. But that may begin to sort of postpone possibly, because I thought the Federal Reserve may raise rates in July or August, but I think it's going to be more like October because we don't have inflation. However, once we come to October, recognize gasoline prices fell October of last year. So we compare October of this year versus October of last year gasoline prices. Now we no longer get that negative pricing. So now we will begin to see that some other prices begin to impact inflation. And one thing that will impact inflation is rents. Rents are now rising at a 7-year high. And it's likely to continue to increase because the vacancy rates on apartments are running very, very low. So the low vacancy rate, rising rent, that's assuring that the overall inflation may begin to pick up later in the year and going into next year, and the Federal Reserve has to anticipate that. That's why they have to raise rate this year, because inflation rate will be rising. So my guess is that printing of the money or quantitative easing is already finished. Fed rate hike is probably going to be October. September is what I projected last month in Washington when we had that 8,000 realtor members. Since that time, the economy is much slower than before. Inflation is lower than before, so I have changed a little bit to October in my view. But I don't think it really matters whether September or October. But the 10-year Treasury will be moving at this point, and the mortgage rate, essentially, you just add up 2 points to this. So the mortgage rate will be about 4.5% by year end. Mortgage rate will be about 5.5% by end of 2016. So mortgage rate will be rising. But still, historically, you just step back and say, those are still attractive rates situation. One big compensating factor to rising rates is first, jobs, more jobs, those are a big compensating factor. But the second compensating factor is credit box may open up. Lenders are dangling, come and get it, this low rates. You bring your client over and they say, sorry, what can I give it to you? So the mortgages availability has been limited to only select few people. But this opportunity for opening up at a rising interest rate environment, because first, they're trying to change some of the FICO score methodology to boost overall, in general, people's credit score, to say that if people lost their job during the Great Recession and miss one mortgage payment, why are they being suffered? Because it's not really their situation. It was more economic situation. So they're trying to change some of that. The Fannie and Freddie is trying to introduce lower down payment products. FHA has reduced their premiums. That may be able to reduce their premium even more next year. And also some of the lenders, their portfolio lending. Generally speaking, all the lenders, Chase, Bank of America, Wells Fargo, local lenders, they're lending because they can sell it to Fannie and Freddie. But some of the lenders are now recognizing mortgages are not defaulting. So maybe they just lend and keep it in the bank. So there's an increased portfolio lending as well. So I think the credit box will be opening up. And thank God, because first we want greater opportunity, but this would be occurring at a rising interest rate environment. So with that, I will reserve the real estate market outlook for the second half. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yoon. You've been incredible. So please welcome back Dr. Lawrence Yoon. Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, I wanted to be very careful. I turned it off. I was carrying this, and I had to do a restroom break. So. Believe me, I attend conferences and so forth. You will hear background noises where people forget to turn it off and they're wandering away someplace. I graduated from Purdue as an undergrad, and then I went to Maryland to get my doctorate degree in economics. I see my fellow colleagues, students, now they are doing well and so forth. Sometimes they ask me, now I see your name on the print a lot in the newspaper, and certainly that must be satisfying certain influence. Or did you envision that you will be working for the National Association of Realtors? And I say that I am very satisfied in what I do. And the reason why I say I am very happy and satisfied in what I do is story like this, where realtors are really involved in a community, helping out in charitable functions, as part of the core standards, giving credit, essentially, notch mark to say your association is doing this and that, are terrific. These are heartwarming stories, and furthermore, I think you also get that personal satisfaction level, particularly for the first-time buyer where they're transitioning from renting into ownership. Now, we don't want to have the bubble situation where the ownership is a temporary, so we want to assure that it's a successful long-term ownership, which is the case in today's market. But those are very satisfying, and I'm glad to see that forgot my father's house is so that realtors participated. The other part is that all of you have opportunity to participate by saying I want to volunteer for this committee or that committee. At the hallway, I was asked by one realtor to say, wouldn't it be great if there is a way to reduce some student debt load for younger generation? And my response to that was the following. Well, first, you look at the reality. The reality is that interest rate on student debt is very high, much higher than anything out there. So, you have to say, why is it so high? And is it possible to bring it back down to what appears to be more market rate? And that's something worth. But I said, that's not for me to decide. That is for you to decide. And when I say you, I say, well, just mention it to the local association president, I'll mention it, and maybe they will mention it at the state association. And the state association, as a group, as a committee, at Rotary Committee, decide to say, we want to bring this to a national attention. And it gets discussed at the national meetings, and at the national meetings, these are all Realtor members are sitting around the table to say, should we set a policy? And regarding the student debt loans situation, I would say currently there's a within the committee a split. One saying that, well, let's try to bring the interest rate down for the student debt to the more market rate, or maybe other measures. The other group essentially saying that this is not a real estate issue, and we should not try to tiptoe into something that is not directly real estate because it can come back to haunt us. For example, I think 30 years ago, NAR actually came out with a policy to say that we need to reduce budget deficit. Now, I mean, that's an admirable goal, and certainly, you know, something the country should strive for. But then the discussion came, how do you reduce the national debt? Do you give in mortgage interest deduction? You know, what happens and all that, you know, so it's suddenly good. If you have strong views, talk to the local association president so they can mention it to the state association and maybe bubbles up to the national committees to something to discuss. So participate. I did not know coming in today that you had a special state level $50 tax credit on any political contribution. So in essence, that's like you donate $50, you get it back. I did not realize that. And I think the only thing that would be holding that back is people's inertia. There's a lot of things in behavioral economics. John Nash, Professor John Nash, who was featured in the movie, Oscar-winning movie, The Beautiful Mind. I mean, he sort of started out some of the human interaction, many aspects, and subsequently led to other economists to consider. But one of his ideas was that people have this natural inertia, which is to say that even though it may be in their interest, because they're busy with something else or not focusing on it, they don't click it. For example, if you put opt-in as a default mode, people are automatically opt-in, whether, you know, healthcare insurance, whatever it is, they're automatically opt-in. But if the default is opt-out, most people choose opt-out. And you cannot say, hey, you know, people are choosing to. So the system itself determines what the results is. And I think the $50 on the RPAC contribution, it seemed like it's a no-brainer. You get your money back right on that. But furthermore, people who are contributing in excess of $50, I want to say thank you very much. I always believe that the best charity that you can provide is to assure that you and your family are financially sound. So assure that is the first thing. But if you have something left over and you can contribute a little more in whether your personal charity or on RPAC, thank you very much, because that really helps my job in Washington. Yesterday, I was in a meeting with the Consumer Protection Finance Bureau. And it's hard to say whether they're protecting consumers or they're clogging up the system. But the thing is, there's a new mortgage rule that goes into effect on August 1st, which then gives, without going into all the details, essentially gives consumers more chance to back out of a deal. So they sign a contract, now they see something wrong, they can back out of the deal. Technology is supposed to improve the system, but some of the new regulation, new rules may actually make the system drag on for longer and longer and longer. It's not due to technology, but it's sometimes due to the new rules and laws. But anyway, we were very concerned that this new rule is getting implemented on August 1st. August is one of the heaviest months for closing activity. So why choose August? Why not December? We've been talking about this, and they said, no, we just, you know, I think, well, August will be fine. So last month, when we had 8,000 realtors come to Washington, the leadership of the local association will be coming to Washington and so forth. If you want to be a part of the leadership, say you wanted to, and try to get your vote of your fellow realtors. So people are in Washington, and one of the things that we did in Washington is that, well, the Consumer Protection Finance Agency, they are not really listening to us. So one way we can force them to listen is, let's talk to the members of Congress So realtors talk with their members of Congress to say, sign this, to say, we have strong concern about August 1st deadline. And the Congress, I think we had something like 350 members of Congress, send a joint letter to this agency to say, please reconsider August as being the date to another date. So late yesterday in the afternoon, Consumer Protection Finance Bureau said, August 1st is still the date, but we will provide more leniency about how that is being implemented. I'm not totally satisfied with that. I wish they would move it to December when the closing activity is very few so that any disruption, we would note it right away, not in August. But at least that moved the dial a bit to say that they will be more lenient, understanding that August is a heavy closing month. But we will work more on it. But things like protecting mortgage interest deduction, that issue always comes up year in, year out. And our PAC contribution really makes the discussion smoother. And some people say, you know, money corrupts the politics. But I think the best way to look at it is what Winston Churchill said. Democracy is the worst form of government, except for all others. To say that it's not perfect, but it's the best that's around. It's right to free speech. This is how you express free speech. Some people have plenty of time, but you are busy doing open houses, so you cannot constantly, you know, call your congressman. So one thing you can do is to do the RPAC, letting the staff go through the system and express your views into people. Another part is, if you cannot contribute to RPAC, again, family comes first, your financial situation is the most and topmost in terms of charitable action. But if you have, if you cannot go anything beyond on the RPAC, is the call to action. You get many emails nowadays. I guess that's the one drawback of technology, just junk mails everywhere. Every once in a while, we'll send email from NAR on a very important issue. We set up a system to make it very easy, user-friendly for your perspective. So for example, let's say the Congress is thinking about removing mortgage interest deduction. We send an email to you to say, please click on these two buttons, just click. And with your permission, a letter will be sent to your member of Congress to say that you believe mortgage interest deduction is important. So just by clicking, they receive a mail. And Congress, they will say, they don't read all the emails that's coming in, but they count how many are for this or against those issues, and hence, you know, it makes a difference. So call to action involves nothing more than less than a 1 minute of your time, but that also has a big impact in terms of supporting NAR policy. One of the NAR big policy, mortgage interest deduction is always a big one at the national level. But it's never at play because we have already spoken to members of Congress. They know how important it is. But one thing that could be at play is that 1031 exchange. That is where, particularly for commercial practitioners, where you are selling one property, you have capital appreciation, you will pay tax on it unless you buy another property of similar, then you can defer the taxes to later. So this is very important for commercial members or even some residential member who have rental property. You want to sell that property, so it has an impact. And it requires a lot of education because we have many members of Congress who are, I would say, realtor friendly, meaning that they understand our issues. But when we bring up 1031, they always ask us the question, what is 1031? And when they ask that question, that means first, these are a few of the members of Congress who understand real estate issues, but if they don't understand 1031, think of other members of Congress who don't understand 1031. If members of Congress do not understand what 1031 is or how important it is to get the transaction done, move resources in their most efficient way, you know, to better entrepreneurs and so forth, if people don't know that, that means when it's time for budget review, that is to say, how do we raise tax revenue, how do we cut the budget deficit, they said, something they don't understand, put it on the table, let's chop it out. And 1031 has a support of two political parties, Democrats and Republicans, in terms of being on the chopping block currently. From the Republicans' point of view, they want to chop it out. Why? Because they said there's too much loophole in the tax system. We remove the loopholes, And we simplify the tax code, and we have lower tax rates. So they would say that. On the Democrat side, they said, well, if we remove 1031, more money comes to Washington. That's what we want. So both political parties are looking to chop away at 1031. So that could be at play until we really educate them on the importance of it. And that's where the call to action will come into play. And certainly our PAC money will help in electing people who understand things like 1031 exchange issues. All right, now having said that, now let's go to the real estate forecast, see what we can anticipate. I want to start first from the commercial because I think this continuing education credit that some of you are receiving, you know, involves all aspects. On the commercial part, this is the deal activity, how many deals are being done. So large, then total crash, and then it's beginning to come back. In the real estate, we are in the residential real estate, home sales, we also saw a crash, but the crash was not to this extent. Note that it went from here to here, that's about 90% reduction. Imagine if someone was to say 90% of your business would disappear, what would happen? But this is what occurred. And the reason why it occurred was because on the commercial real estate, it doesn't have equivalent of Fannie and Freddie. Fannie and Freddie made huge mistakes. Their management were wild. They thought that it was worth getting $20 million bonuses and so forth. In hindsight, it was at the taxpayer's expense. So Fannie and Freddie made a huge gamble, developed this huge hedge fund and so forth. But the reason why we have Fannie and Freddie is not for that. The reason why we have Fannie and Freddie is to assure that consumers have access to lower mortgage rates and consistent 30-year fixed rate mortgages. Because without Fannie and Freddie, 30-year fixed rate mortgage may disappear. So NAR had a committee review it and said, you know, we don't like this, all this what Fannie and Freddie had done in the past, taxpayer bailout and so forth. So let's assure that those things do not occur, have some reform, but we still need to assure that there needs to be some government guarantee on it to assure that we have that 30-year fixed rate mortgages and it doesn't collapse 90%. So housing did collapse in terms of business activity by 30 or 40%. That's painful, but it was not the 90% collapse that it could have happened. But commercial real estate, ever since that crash, they're steadily coming up. And this is what you will see in the Wall Street Journal or, say, CNBC, Bloomberg TV program, that commercial market is making a steady increase in business activity. With increase in business activity, the prices on commercial buildings are also beginning to rise again, reaching back to the prior peak levels. So this made it much easier on the refinances. Commercial mortgages are of short durations, 5 years, 10 years, and then they have to refi. When the prices were down, they didn't have collateral to refi. So they said, if you want to refi, bring in additional $50,000 or additional $200,000, then we can refi, because there was no collateral value to back it up. But now the prices are much higher, it makes the refinancing activity much easier because all the commercial mortgages are of short duration. It's short duration because it doesn't have the Fannie and Freddie back guarantee. On the other commercial metric, because there's different price measurement, something called Green Street is already surpassed a peak. But Green Street actually only measures those super expensive property in Manhattan and San Francisco, and they ignore many of the corner shops, the corner bakery or the gas station that some of you may be involved in. So on the expensive properties, really rising very, very fast. On the residential market, the red is the newly constructed homes. Blue is the existing homes. So we had a housing market bubble. So it sort of rose a little faster than historical trend. And then subsequent crash. And ever since that crash, it's been recovering. One thing to note is we are still well shy of what it had been. So some discussion about this being a bubble. It's not. This is not the bubble activity of subprime lending and some large number of people coming in. People who are buying today are solid credit score individuals who are coming in. The second thing to note is that new homes here, that red bar, is much smaller now than in the past because builders are not building all that much new homes. This is the pending contract activity. So at least the contract to buy a home have now reached, I think, 8 or 9 year high on a monthly basis. So this is implying that closing activity will be very strong this summer. Closing activity will be very solid this summer. Hopefully, nearly all of the pending goes into closing, because we know that some of the pending do not go into closing, and one of the most frustrating part of the business. But the pending contract is really rising strongly. And I believe that this not only this good summer that I am anticipating this year, but I think it's going to be overall good year next year, and even possibly over the next 5 years, improving year. Maybe I will say, you know, I will not be presumptuous and so to say that I don't know everything what's going to happen. You know, there's too many uncertainty. But I would say maybe in the you visualize 5 years of your business, next 5 years. Is it going to be good? Should I be worried? Should I be cautious? What should be happening? I would say overall, in the next 5 years, 4 of those 5 years should be an improving year for you. And when I say 4 or 5 years, I just give 1 year caveat, because you never know what's going to happen, because there's a huge pent-up demand. And what do I mean by pent-up demand? Year 2000, so let me quickly go back this. Year 2000, this is the year, and this is the bubble. So year 2000, we had 5.2 million home sales. Last year, we had 4.9. This year, we may hit 5.2. This year, we may hit 5.2 because it's going to be a good summer. And then new home sales is this. So we are only matching up with the year 2000. Year 2000 is a very good reference year to compare, not because it's somehow turn of the century, but because in the year 2000, economists were not debating about housing market bubble or crash. Housing market was very non-eventful, boring news. So your local paper may say 45 homes were sold last week or something like that. And it was no big deal. It's just another news. No one was saying, oh, it's bubble-ish or it's going to crash or anything. So it was very boring year, which means probably a very normal year. Well, we are pretty much a normal year or a little subpar compared to normal. But there's a one big difference between the year 2000 and the year 2014. Population has risen. America is one of the few wealthy industrialized countries still have a respectable population growth. Japan population is probably declining. Germany is probably topping out. Italy is probably declining. France barely growing. But America, we are adding about 3 million more people each year due to the natural birth minus death process and legal immigration that's coming into the country. We are adding population, so we have about close to 40 million additional people living in the country, yet we have same number of home sales. So it's huge pent-up demand. This pent-up demand will steadily reach the market over the next 5 years. Where are all these people living if we have population increase but people are not buying home? Well, many are living with their parents. You know, adult children, they graduate from college, but now they're back at home, just like the high school days. They're back with their home. And I can say that that is not their vision of the American dream, to live with their parents. They want to move out, but they are looking for better economic times. And you can say economy is sluggish, but at least it's improving. It's improving and improving, and therefore, as long as we have consistent positive GDP, even if we don't get that 3%, even if it's 2% GDP, we will have a steady flow of people moving out of their parents' basement and seeking out their own household, first as renters, and hopefully over time they save enough money and become home buyers. So we have this huge pent-up demand in the upcoming years to support the housing. So home buying has come up, and right now the prices are rising, and in fact, too fast in my point of view. All real estate is different, so the hottest market, I would say, is probably the San Jose, Denver, and Seattle market. Those are the hottest market where prices are rising 15%, multiple bid, becoming just common normal occurrence. In the Northeast, you know, you go to Connecticut, New Jersey, it's sluggish. Prices are not rising at all, so it varies depending on where you are. But based on some conversation I'm having, that you are saying, no, the multiple bidding is becoming common here also. So which means that price increases, well, that is The price increase, I'm glad my wife is not here. She sees this, she immediately gets a migraine. So even a police siren, she sees that she has to cover her eyes, any flashing of the lights. And the price are rising very fast because inventory level is low. So this is the inventory. I think the local area month supply is like 2 months supply, which is very, very tight. You go to Seattle, less than a month supply of inventory. So how do we get more inventory? Well, we get more inventory if the builders build more. Now, some people have said that if some people who are underwater with price increases, they become above water, so now they can list their home. So that's an inventory. And answer is yes and no. It is yes, they're now listing their home. They've been waiting and waiting for the price increases. Now they're above water, they're listing. But they're listing to do what? To buy a home. So they're putting their home on the market to buy a home, so they're net zero in terms of overall inventory impact. So from business perspective, you welcome that. That's an additional transaction. But from the market point of view, it still does not help the overall inventory situation. Only way we get a clean, empty home inventory is through home building. And home building activity is, one can see, sometimes rises very rapidly. It's a cyclical industry. But this time around, it's rising very, very slowly and well below that red line. I mean, red line is where it needs to be in order to help us relieve the inventory pressure. So that's where we are currently regarding housing starts. And the builders, spec homes they build, how long does it take to find a buyer? Right now, it takes about 3 months to find a buyer. They don't have problem finding a buyer. Then you say to yourself, well, let me see this. Home builders build, they don't have problem finding a buyer, they're probably making a profit, yet they're not producing that much. And you feel like slapping the home builders and say, wake up, you know, there's a market going on, we have shortage of inventory, build more homes. Let me go back to commercial and then come back to the home builders because it's related. I show you the commercial market increased business activity. That's what's reported in the Wall Street Journal. But we took a survey of realtor commercial members, and we said, what type of activity are you involved in? And most commercial members, this is commercial members, were saying they were doing about $1 million or less than $1 million property deals. The chart that I showed you that's being reported in Wall Street Journal, those are all $2.5 million or over. If it's under $2.5 million, they don't cover it. So, but our realtor members are involved in a smaller property transactions. Again, gas stations, the retail shop around the corner, those type of deals. And our members, okay, now this one, I will ask to send by email or maybe posting on the website because you will get a better graphing on it. And we asked, where do you get the source of financing to do those commercial market deals? And essentially, they get their commercial members get source of financing not from Wall Street, not surprisingly. They get the source of financing from local community banks. And this is where I want to tie in the home builders and the commercial real estate builders. Dodd-Frank, Affordable Care Act, many people will benefit, many people are unhappy about. It was passed by one vote along party line. Dodd-Frank was another massive legislation on financial regulation. Some people are happy about it, other people are unhappy about it. It was passed by, I think, one vote along party line. And how is Dodd-Frank impacting home builders and the commercial real estate? First, Senator Dodd from Connecticut and Representative Frank from Massachusetts, after they passed this bill, they retired. I don't know how that works. So they pass a bill and then they retire. But the home building that is being done today, it's been done by national builders, KB Homes, Lennar, Toll Brothers, who can tap Wall Street money, issue stocks and bonds, get the money, buy land, lots, and start building. Big builders are in the game. But most of home building in America historically has done by local small-time builders who build 10 homes a year, 20 homes a year, using local community banks. And the smaller guys are out of the game. And you say, why are you out of the game? Because they are saying, I cannot get the construction loan from the local banks. Commercial real estate members are saying, those increase in chart that you show, I don't buy that. I don't see it in my business. My business is more sideline. It's moving sideways. I don't really see that big increase in commercial activity. And they said, what's holding back the activity? They cannot get the loans from the community banks. And the community banks are saying, we cannot give you the loans anymore because there's too much regulation, financial costs coming from Dodd-Frank. I'm just passing on the message. Maybe they're exaggerating their statement, but they are saying Dodd-Frank has really limited their ability to lend more on the real estate. So they cannot lend it to home builders as much. And that's why we have this inventory shortage and prices are rising a little too fast because local builders just cannot get the construction loan like they used to. Some people are saying, anecdotally, they are able to get a loan, but a little differently. In the past, they get a construction loans to build 20 homes. Today, they get a construction loans to build 2 homes. They build it, find a buyer, then pay back, then they get a loan to buy, build 2 more homes. So one can see a much slower process that's occurring than before. So one of the things that we are now in discussion with another trade association in Washington is to see if we can change some of the Dodd-Frank elements. First, it's not going to be overturned, anything like that, but you are looking at, you know, how do you improve upon what has been already passed? Intent of Dodd-Frank is to assure that we don't have another financial market crisis. Sometimes I wonder, because anytime there's a bubble, you know, there's a Mississippi land bubble, there's the internet stock bubble, there's bubble, you know, railroad track bubble and everything. So once the greed start going, you know, greed really start moving along until the pain occurs. So trying to regulate human behavior or trying to regulate human folly, is that possible? But this is an attempt at that to assure that we don't have a financial market crisis. But the financial market crisis were caused by all this large financial institution in Wall Street. And one other thing about Wall Street is that if one goes down through the derivative linkage, it can pull down other companies along with it, and the whole financial system could collapse. So we don't want that to occur. So we hate the banks, but somehow we need the banks. We cannot have the whole banking industry collapse. So therefore, they're trying to do more regulation on it. Then you look at the small community bank, and you say, well, how many small community banks are there in America? 10,000. If one goes under, is it a big problem? You say, no, one goes under, no big deal. 2 goes under, no big deal. 5 goes under, no big deal. 5 makes huge profit, no big deal. 1 makes huge profit, no big deal. Community banks are 10,000 of them. 1, 2 goes under or over, who cares? They don't cause systemic risk. But in the Wall Street, if Lehman Brothers go down, Goldman Sachs go down, it brings the whole financial system down with it. So if the goal is to prevent future financial crisis, maybe we should have this Dodd-Frank intended, I don't know the outcome, but at least they intended on the large banks. On the smaller bank, let them be free of the Dodd-Frank and let them just do their business. They succeed, they succeed. They go under, they go under. But at least by not having this excessive regulation, they can lend, try to lend more to home builders, try to lend for commercial real estate, and get the business to start going. So that's one of the things that we are doing in Washington to discuss with the members of Congress and, you know, go ties into the RPAC where it helps the discussion part smoother. So this is something that we are going to do to assure that we don't have this persistent inventory shortage. But the local market, you are more attuned to this, but the statistics are quite eye-popping. You know, pendings are up 28%. Closings are up 28%. Inventory level 1.8 months supply. That assures the prices will be rising at double-digit rate of appreciation. And if you're homeowners, that's good. If you are the sellers who are able to make the transaction, that's good. Higher prices, that's good. But if you are a buyer representative in a multiple bidding, it's an unhappy situation because 10 people are making a bid. 1 is happy, 9 is unhappy. They have to start all over again. So it's not good for the real estate practitioner, you know, all the efforts that you put into it. And hence, you know, and also for the home buyers, millennial generation, where their incomes are rising only 2%, you cannot have 6% and nearly 10%. I think it's going to go up to 10% based on month supply situation, because then it will begin to choke off demand. So you may have a good time now, but it could turn negative if the prices rise way, way too fast. Another reason why we don't have a bubble, I'm showing you the more demand situation, we are not at the bubble demand. Second part is we don't have oversupply. During the bubble years, 2 million new housing. Today is 1 million, half that rate. So that's another reason why we don't have a bubble situation. And this is the greater Portland market in terms of new home construction activity. From 1990, so you know, one can see that with the population moving in, that this has been the norm. So for three straight years, virtually nothing, and then now you are coming out. First, you have to compensate for that low levels, but based on the month supply, it looks like it needs to go up at least up to, you know, like 15,000 or levels very soon. Don't expect any inventory help from the shadow inventory. What is a shadow inventory? These are currently distressed homeowners who cannot make mortgage payments or already in foreclosure process. So these are homes you know will pop into the market at some point. Some people say there's a huge shadows. We don't need home builders. The shadows will reach the market. That will solve inventory problem. But we have far fewer shadow inventory today than before. Seriously delinquent mortgages, people who have missed their mortgage payment by more than 3 months or are already in foreclosures, it's been cut in half. So if you specialize in foreclosure properties, change your business model, because there will be far fewer of foreclosure properties in the future. And this is the distressed property sale trend in the U.S., going down, down, and down, because we have fewer and fewer shadows in the market. Not all shadows are the same between the states. The red is New Jersey, one of the worst level of shadow inventory, and one is green is Oregon. So you are, you know, much lower level, and it's shrinking. In the New Jersey, they have a huge court system. So if someone does not pay mortgages, it may take banks up to 3 years to kick the person out. Arizona, California, again, you know, every state is different. For whatever reason, Arizona, California, you don't pay a mortgage, they will kick you out immediately. That's why they don't have shadow inventory. It's been cleared out very quickly. But in New Jersey, you don't pay your mortgage, you can expect to stay there for 3 years without being kicked out. And they know that. So what do? They don't pay mortgage. For 3 years, they save money. And once they're kicked out, they use their saved money to buy a home all cash. They who need credit score? Something does not feel right, all right? These are very, I'm sure, a small percentage. It's not an, you know, active thing, but some people are really gaming the system, knowing that this is the rule of the game. Homeowners, interestingly, currently are staying much longer than before selling their home. So it used to be about 7 years before they put their homes on the market. You know, life cycle changes, you know, additional kids, better school district, and all that. But it's been up to now 10 years on nationwide basis. I show this vehicle sales, because vehicle sales is like this. It crashed, then it bounced back up, almost back to their prior levels. I show you this because during the downturn, people held on to their vehicle for longer. So rather than holding their vehicle for, say, 6 years, they held on their vehicle for 10 years, and it's understandable, economic downturn. But now that the market is improving, it has rapidly come back. But it's not rapidly come back for housing. You have already seen the chart. It's coming back, so you are welcoming that, but it's not coming back like the vehicle sales. Regarding car loans, there's no new regulation on car loans. It's the same as before. So it's just bouncing back up. But on the mortgages, everything has changed. You know, new qualifying mortgage rule, new Consumer Protection Bureau, Dodd-Frank, all that. So even though people are staying much longer, the recovery phase for housing is different than for the vehicles because their lending situation is a different environment. Now, let me also talk about American inequality because I think this will be one of the major presidential campaign issues from both political parties, because first, America has become more unequal. And I believe that one of the key reason driver is home ownership rate has really fallen to 25-year low levels. And why is this matters? First, the rental population has really bloomed. So if you have investment property, you will have tenants, and rents are going up. So this is good in that sense. But homeowner population has fallen, and that's why we have 25-year low home ownership rate. Take the business side away from you for a while, and you envision America. How do you envision America? Should home ownership rates be part of that American dream? Now again, go to the 1930s, the Great Depression. I think Tom Brokaw used the term the greatest generation for people who lived through the Great Depression, went to Europe, fought the war, or went to the Pacific Islands, fought the war, won the war, came back home, and built American economy to be the world's greatest. And they didn't expect anything. They just said, well, this is what you do. You just work at it. And hence, Tom Brokaw labeled it as the greatest generation. When I look at that period, I view the period as America moving from working class to middle class, because now finally they are enjoying the benefits of their labor, and the benefit of their labor is owning their home. So the fact that home ownership rate is falling to 25-year lows may be counter to American dream, unless people say owning is not part of my American dream. But survey after survey still shows, even among younger generation, that their eventual goal is to own a home. They consider that to be part of the American dream. So home ownership rate is falling at a time when prices are rising. Warren Buffett, I think 4 years ago, live on CNBC, did his Warren Buffett thing. Everyone listen. At the end of the interview, final question from the reporter said, all right, where should Americans put their money right now? Average Americans, where should they put their money? And Warren Buffett said, if you have enough money for down payment, buy a home. That was his advice. And the people who took that advice, they will be accumulating wealth today. So that would be the situation. Yet we have a situation where cash has become more important than before, because obtaining mortgage is very difficult. So now we have a greater share of cash transactions now than before, which means that mortgages have become excessively tight. You have to somehow know family members, you know, help out one way or another, trying to get the cash to make the deal happen. And let me just skip that. And the most important thing is this one. The financial wealth between renters and homeowners. Your lifetime financial achievement. Not 1 year of income, but what do you have to show for all your life regarding finances? Data from the Federal Reserve, renters, they have on average about $5,000 to show for. The money in the bank, automobile asset, what do you have? $5,000. It doesn't change from 1 year to the next. For homeowners, it's substantially greater. Today it's about $200,000, much larger than $5,000 for renters. Some homeowners are underwater, so maybe they are not in a great strait, but on average, homeowners have much more. I mean, many homeowners have paid off their mortgages after 30 years. And now prices are increasing, so this is rising. So we have a situation where homeowner wealth is rising, but we have fewer homeowners. So America has automatically become more unequal in the process. So I think one of the campaign theme is to address homeownership, better access to credit for people to come back. Pendulum, always moves completely one way or the other. Lose credit, too tight credit. We just want it back to normal. But we don't want just suddenly more buyers coming into the market. We need to have more supply. So we need to have more construction activity and hopefully some relaxation on Dodd-Frank regulation on the smaller size banks. On the smaller size bank may provide that impetus for the home builders to come back to the market so we can have more supply. And the stock market has really zoomed. This is another source of inequality, because who owns the stock market? Half of you have some exposure to the stock market, but 10% has real meaningful amount. So about 40% of you have small amount in stock market, and half of you have no amount in the stock market. So when the stock market runs up, it's really the 10% who are benefiting. regarding this, I think the home ownership rate, I think, will be another big sort of middle class wealth contributors. One impact of this is that Bend, Oregon, is lively now. You know, you went through the crash, but the employment growth is very solid. People are buying vacation homes. So have some relationship. Maybe the, some places around Mount Hood, you know, beautiful. So there are more demand for vacation home now than before, because people on the top end have done really well, and they are now looking towards more vacation homes. Forecast, so final forecast is the following. I don't see a recession occurring. So first quarter GDP was sluggish, but it's a one-time factor. So I think we're going to get back to 2%. Note that it's not 3%. Maybe next year we'll get up to the 3% level. But the job momentum is solid, so job growth will continue. And Portland always does a little better than the national average. Inflation, nothing this year, then beginning to creep up next year because you don't get the benefit of lower gasoline prices. It's the same gasoline prices that that will be the case, but the rents are rising. On the housing picture, a lot of numbers, but the numbers are for national level. I don't make any specific local market forecasts other than to say that Portland will outdo the nation. So housing start will steadily increase. Even in 2016, 1.4 million housing start is still insufficient, but at least it's moving in the right direction. It will help on the inventory front. Existing homes will begin to, again, climb. I think in the next 5 years, four of those 5 years will be an improvement year. Prices will is nearly guaranteed to increase because of shortage of inventory. We just hope that there's more supply, more construction to tame the price growth. But the mortgage rate will be rising. In 2016, but I think big compensating factor will be the underwriting standards. It's been strict. Maybe this year some transition where they slowly open up the credit box, and next year maybe things become more normal. So something that we need in a rising interest rate environment. I spent half of your day this morning with you, so thanks for your passion, and thank you very much. Thank you.